Gracilaria Culture Handbook for New England. This project was funded by the Long Island Sound Futures Fund through the National Fish and Wildlife Foundation. Research was conducted at the University of Connecticut's Marine Biotechnology Laboratory in Stamford and at the Bridgeport Regional Aquaculture Science and Technology Education Center. Special thanks to Purchase College, Connecticut Sea Grant, and Rocking the Boat for additional support.
My lab at the University of Connecticut at Stamford is involved in looking at the ecophysiology and ecology of seaweeds. We are also very interested in cultivation on a large scale in the open sea or cultivation on land.
Macroalgae are important and valuable resources for both man and sea, providing food, oxygen, shelter, and habitat while playing an important role in biogeochemical cycling. They convert the energy of the sun and dissolved inorganic nutrients into organic biomass that can then be harvested and used for food, phycocolloids, various extracts, fertilizer, and as an energy source.
The Gracilaria that we are growing prefers to grow in the warmer periods of the seasons in New England area, so it's what we call a warm temperate species. The range of Gracilaria extends from northern Florida all the way up into the state of New Hampshire, the Great Bay Estuary.
Gracilaria is a genus of red algae with considerable economic importance worldwide. Found in warmer waters, many Gracilaria species are wild harvested or cultivated for food and agar, a commercially important phycocolloid. There is only one native species of Gracilaria in New England, Gracilaria tikvahiae. Gracilaria is a bushy, branching red seaweed that can appear yellow, red, brown, or almost black. Gracilaria is a warm water seaweed that can tolerate a wide range of environmental conditions, with an optimal temperature range of 20 to 30 degrees Celsius and an optimal salinity range of 25 to 33 parts per thousand. Gracilaria can be found attached or floating in bays and estuaries throughout New England. Gracilaria has a three-part life cycle with an isomorphic alternation of generations. This means that two of its life stages are morphologically identical. The tetrasporophytes and gametophytes are indistinguishable until their reproductive structures appear. When mature, the tetrasporophyte develops dark spots on the surface of the tissue. These are tetrasporangia, each containing four haploid tetraspores. Once released, the non-motile tetraspores settle and adhere to a substrate, usually within 24 hours. Spores germinate and form multicellular discs that will develop a 3-centimeter erect cylindrical thallus in about 2 months. Tetraspores develop into either male or female gametophytes. Male gametophytes can be distinguished under a microscope with the appearance of the spermatangia appearing as a white mottling on the cortex. Females are distinguishable only after the egg has been fertilized on the cortex. The zygote develops into the third life stage, the cystocarp, directly on the female branches. Cystocarps appear as bumps on the female plant. Cystocarps release carpospores, which will settle and develop into tetrasporophytes. The life cycle moves from carpospore to tetrasporophyte and tetraspore to gametophyte to cystocarp. Cultures are initiated from wild reproductive adult plants. Select clean, healthy plants that are free from epiphytes and transport in coolers back to the lab for further processing. The cleaning process is a critical step for establishment of clean cultures. Wild collected plants should be rinsed and sorted when they are brought into the lab. Reproductive branches and branches with actively growing tips can then be selected for further processing. Collected branches are gently scrubbed with a clean cotton tip swab to remove epiphytes and then transferred to clean seawater. Culture initiation from spore allows the grower to establish known life stages and is more likely to result in clean cultures. Tetraspores and carpospores can be isolated in the lab using the same technique. Reproductive branches are selected from clean plants and placed in petri dishes with sterile seawater overnight. Released spores are then isolated under a microscope and placed on glass slides to settle and germinate. Isolated spores can be cultured in petri dishes at 20 degrees Celsius in sterile VSE-enriched seawater. A new upright frond should develop in about 2 months. Cultures can also be initiated by isolating the actively growing tips. Tips are cut with a clean razor blade, scrubbed a second time with a swab, and placed in clean seawater. Tips should be about 5 millimeters, long enough to grasp one end with forceps. The cut end of a tip is grasped with jeweler's forceps and the tip is dragged through a seawater agar plate to remove contaminants. Clean tips can then be cultured at 20 degrees Celsius in sterilized VSE seawater. Each tip will develop into a new plant. As individuals grow, they should be transferred to larger and larger containers. Once a clean culture has been established, it can be expanded by fragmenting one plant into many new plants. Biomass can be built up over time by fragmenting plants and moving into larger and larger tanks. Tank-cultured plants can be outplanted in the sea for continued growth. Fronds are portioned out into equal amounts, tied together into bundles, and then attached to long lines. Bundles are attached to the long line by opening up the twisted section of the rope and pushing the middle section of the bundle through. When the twist in the line closes, it will hold the bundle onto the line. These fronds will continue to grow in the sea and can be harvested on a regular basis. Prepared lines can then be planted at 1 meter depth and cultured from spring till fall.
So you look at that, in 1 meter you can just barely see that in the water.
Yeah.
See that? Barely see it.
Light, temperature, nutrient supply, depth, and density are all important factors in the cultivation of Gracilaria. Gracilaria lines can be harvested approximately every 2 weeks. Lines can be harvested multiple times throughout the season. By harvesting the new growth and then replacing the original bundles. These bundles were harvested after 2 weeks at sea. On the left is before harvest, and on the right is after harvest. Eutrophication is a problem facing many of our coastal areas. This is a result of an influx of nitrogen from land, from agricultural, industrial, and waste runoff. Excess nutrients in the sea can cause algal blooms, which loads the system with excess organic matter and depletes oxygen to dangerous levels. Excess nutrient loading causes an imbalance of the healthy ecosystem and is difficult to manage due to the many sources of inputs. By cultivating marine macroalgae, or seaweeds, we are able to capture some of the dissolved nitrogen and remove it when we harvest. This is called nutrient bioextraction, and can be done by cultivating extractive organisms like shellfish and seaweeds in nutrient-rich areas. Large-scale cultivation of Gracilaria could be an effective bioremediation measure for controlling the effects of eutrophication in coastal areas.